No? But Michael, just think, then you can have one of you go to work and the other one of you stay home.
That'd be really good.
Hey, look, it's Michael.
Yay!
Please stand and join us this morning.
The sun to rise every morning, colors the sky with the shades of his glory, wakes us with mercy and love, Jesus does. Who holds the orphan, comforts the widow, cries for injustice, feels every sorrow, carries the pain of his children, Jesus does. So we sing praise to the Father who gave us a Son, praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, he saved me from who I was, 'cause that's what Jesus does. Who understands the heart of the sinner, showers his grace over all our mistakes, washes us clean with his blood, Jesus does. Who sings the songs of sweet forgiveness? Who stole the keys to hell and the grave? Who has the power to save? Jesus does. So we sing praise to the Father who gave us the Son, praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, he saved me from who I was, 'cause that's what Jesus does. So we sing praise to the Father who gave us the Son, praise to the Spirit who's living in us. When I was a sinner, he saved me from who I was, 'cause that's what Jesus does.
Oh,
return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore, for endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore, for endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God.
Would you please pray with me? Father, would our praises never cease, God? Would our praises be genuine and real in the midst of the trials and the storms and in the good times too? Would our praises be a blessed offering to you? And would we remember you in those times? Would that give us a renewed sense of strength and faith found only in you, Lord? We thank you for Pastor Krisi, and we pray over the message that she's going to give us today. Lord, would we have hearts to receive your word and to leave this place ready to share your word, God, with the people around us, so that we can glorify your name in everything we do. In your name, amen. You can now take a couple minutes to say hello to the people around you, and then we will go into our offering.
Good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Hello, we're glad you're here. Get her hair up.
Hello, welcome to church.
Yeah. Oh, hi, welcome in.
Good morning, everyone.
I'd like to welcome you into our house.
Hey, church, we're glad you're here.
Good morning, it's good to see you.
Oh, hi again.
Hi, welcome to the Peoria Church of Nazarene here in wonderful Peoria, Arizona. We're glad you're here.
Welcome to God's house. May your experience here be spiritual and uplifting. Thank you for coming.
It's great to have you here. Okay.
Good morning and welcome to our service.
Hi, thanks for joining us at Peoria Church of the Nazarene.
It's great to have you joining us.
Okay, we are really chatty this morning. There's like a whole section here that hasn't sat down yet. And I'm okay with that. I was sharing with somebody as I was greeting. Like, it's just good to be alive, and it's good to be out and about and to get out of the house. And what better place to come to than God's house? It's an awesome morning. I'm super encouraged and excited. Welcome again here. Okay. We're not quite there yet, but thank you so much for that support. We're going to start by having the ushers come forward because it's time for... Yeah, it is that. I'm never going to get past the fact that it's really powerful to just stick my hand out there and say a word and people respond. I wish my kids responded that well. No. But we're gonna pray quickly for offering, keeping in mind that the passing of the plates is one way, one opportunity that we have to bring into God's household. You can text to give, which is a really cool tool to use as well. There's information on the back of the bulletin, a QR code. You can hit the QR code. It'll take you to the site. You can get it all set up. Once you have it set up, it's so easy to do. There are other giving opportunities, but I wanted to point that one out on the back of the bulletin. Plus, in doing so, it just gives the ushers a chance to get to where they need to be. Please join me as we pray for this offering. Father God, thank you, Lord, for this beautiful morning and for this opportunity that we have to give. I pray a prayer for everyone who is bringing in their offering, and I pray, Lord, that you would just take this, our humble offering, and multiply it and use it to advance your kingdom work here. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, now, back row, Richard. And thank you, Shearers, for now, once again, being in the front row, waving about your bulletin. It's time for announcements, and I'm thrilled to see everybody actually picking up and using the bulletin. Mine is written all over as I was thinking about stuff to talk about this morning. Couple of things. Not a ton of things, but a couple of things. One thing that I noticed is that later today, I almost got corrected, and then I'm like, no, we call it BEMA. BEMA, small group, is back on the calendar again. Yeah. Woohoo! Yeah. Okay, I'm going to be very transparent with you. I've been here at Peoria for like, I don't know, 5 years or something. I mean, pre-pandemic, which is now starting to mean longer and longer periods of time, right? I did not know what BEMA even was going on. I had no idea. It's been there for a while. But I did notice the absence of that on the list, and now I see that the group is restarting again. And I asked Pastor Krisi this morning, this is actually the group that I should be in because it's my age group. Well, you don't have to be old and gray and balding, but it is roughly my age group. This is kind of the 40s, 50s, 60s, whatever. But they follow this really cool podcast that I'm starting to learn a little bit more, mostly because Logan is encouraging me to be listening to podcasts, which is kind of like, I don't know, neuroscience to me. It's I don't know. I'm trying to get there. But the point is, they follow this really cool podcast, and then they meet to talk about it at 1 o'clock on Sundays. And today they're restarting. And so if that's you, today's your day. And if it's not you, but it is you because you fit the profile, today is still your day. And be here and join them at 1 o'clock. Monday night, no young adult Bible study this week. Wednesday night, our regular stuff, except, I mean, it, as regular as irregular can be, because Wednesday night's Wacky Wednesday theme is mismatch madness, which is irregular. I mean, you know, mismatching, I don't know. Like, you may have noticed, I try to match. I try really hard, but the people in my life would tell you I'm slightly blue-green colorblind, and so it doesn't always work. This is my night when I can mismatch and it does not matter. I don't know if I'm going to hang out with the kids that night, but for the kids who are here on Wednesday night, mismatch madness. Just put plaids and stripes and polka dots and colors and put it all together and show up here to have fun on Wednesday night. New in the bulletin this week, and I think we'll probably see it a little bit more, is baptism classes. I will tell you, I was sharing in the kitchen this morning with some that were gathered there about how much I just really have respect for the tradition and the ceremony of the church, that it just speaks to me because it's a connectedness. This is one of those kind of ceremonies, right, that is so much more. It's so much more because it's this outward profession of our inward attempts at Christ-likeness, our inward change. Baptism is such an important sacrament of the church. There's an opportunity here. Baptism classes are going to be starting Sunday, August 4th, baptism class after morning service. Then the baptism actual is coming on the 18th in the backyard because, you know, it's like 100 and I don't even want to say how many degrees. So that's the right place to have it, where the water can... I made a noise. But if you are thinking about baptism, if you're a candidate for baptism,
put that there.
That's where I wanted it. No, it's not really, because I have to look at it. August 4th is your opportunity. See Pastor Krisi for all of that information. And then there's two more things. Well, okay, there's even three things I want to talk about. So I said not very much, but I lied, as usual, in front of God and everybody. A couple of things. August 9th, DBAC's Faith and Family Night. The deadline to sign up for that really fun time is approaching. Next Sunday, July 28th, last opportunity to reserve your tickets. Now, here's the deal. I brought my phone with me. I usually do have it connected to me at the hand. But I wanted to point out that through the Church Center app, that would be a great sign-up opportunity to do that. There it is right there. Faith and Family Night. Click on it, sign up, get all the information you need. Super convenient and easy right there on the mobile device. And also, where else did I make more? Okay, so that's one thing. One thing is, August 9th is the DBACS Faith and Family event. Next Sunday is the last opportunity to get signed up. The other thing that you could sign up for in the app, and it's listed here on the back of the program, and that is fantasy football! That's good. That was really good. Leave it to Ruben to add a musical note to my announcement. Yeah, that was good. That event is going to be August 10th, and again, the mobile, the app has it right there, Fantasy Football Draft, August 10th, 4 p.m. There is a sign-up sheet in the foyer, or you can sign up right here through the Church Center app. That is my preference, although I didn't find out about this until I had already signed up on the paper, and now if I sign up again, I'm sure I'm going to mess up the system, so I'm not going to sign up there. I signed up on the paper out in the lobby. And then last is, last but not of course least, it's only the last because it's the furthest one out in time that I'm talking about that I'm talking about this morning, and that is Young Adult Retreat on August 16th and 18th. That sign up is also here in the app. It's the pink one to sign up there. It says August 16th through 18th, cost is $150, location is Emmanuel Pines. More information and sign up available in the Church Center app. Okay, that was me really fast through a whole bunch of stuff, but thank you for being patient with me. Doug is going to come up and lead us in our scripture reading today, so welcome, Doug.
Is that what we're doing?
Yes.
Okay, you told me Colossians. That's not Colossians. Okay. If you'll read with me. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. John 1, 1 to 5.
Thank you. Children are ready to go. Go. Now's your chance. I will have to say this. You know, we're a church family. We use that phrase a lot. I don't want to scare off the Darfuses by my many mistakes. Then once again, this has happened. The Darfuses are so patient, and they're just willing to be part of the church and serve where they can. But twice, I've called them up as those that are passing out communion, and I got too many people that Sunday. And now I had Doug read scripture, and yesterday I was like, I'm going to prep him. I'm going to be ready. And I gave him the wrong passage. That's on me. Doug, sorry. If they leave, it's my fault. Just going to confess that now. So I do want to talk about baptism just for a minute. That is something new for some of you to hear. Baptism is one of two things that we consider sacramental in the Nazarene Church, that it is a holy command by the Lord, and baptism has this special significance. So yes, it's just water. It is a symbol of the internal work that Jesus has done from within. So we say it's the external expression of dying to self, being forgiven, rose again. But it also holds this community element. So it is done communally. And as the one being baptized comes up out of the water, it is the community celebrating as if to say, join us, that we recognize, all of us, that we've been invited by the King to join and be adopted into his family. And so it is super fun to celebrate that. So we are offering the class to see if there's anybody. I've heard a few people mention it, and then I'm open to direct conversation, but also on August 4th, we're going to have a class. Now, you can attend the class to find out more about baptism and not say that you're ready to be baptized for the 18th, but you also will want to join in if you know for sure, hey, I'd like to be baptized. So we had this really cool experience several years back. Do you remember we put the pool out and there were 18 that ended up being baptized? That was a long baptism. It was beautiful. But you know what? I'm willing to fill up the pool and gather around everybody if it's just one. So if you've not been baptized and you're curious about that, or feel free to come talk to me, but we'll have an official class on August 4th, and we'll give you kind of the rundown, and that'll be your chance to chat with me as well. So know that that is a great, great Sunday. And I didn't have this in the announcement because I thought, well, I don't know. We'll see who, you know, how this plays out, since I didn't have anybody directly come to me yet. But I thought, you know what? We're still going to do this even if none are prepared for baptism. We're going to do a potluck. Yeah. And so it'll be really cool to do it after a baptism, but it's going to be just as cool even if we don't have a baptism. So we're going to do a potluck on the 18th. And you know why? We have a kitchen that works. Yeah, I know. Oh, makes such a big difference when the ovens turn on or don't just immediately go to broil. The food tastes so much better that way. Even I know that. And I mean, that's a basic level of kitchen. That's kitchen 101, is if the equipment works, you have a much better shot of it turning out well. So we're going to gather together on the 18th, and if even one wants to be baptized, we'll be doing a baptism, and we'll celebrate afterwards with our, we're pretty good at potlucks, with our potlucks. Every time I sit there in the morning and I think, oh, what else do I need to get? What if people have forgotten and we don't have enough food? Why do I say that to myself? When has that ever happened? Never here. We get to the end of the potluck and I'm running around going, you know, there's seconds or thirds. Feel free to come around. We're pretty good at the potluck. So we have plenty to eat. All right. I want to know if any of you have ever been spelunking. Oh, okay, there's a few. I heard a giggle, meaning they know what it is, but maybe have not attempted it. How many have actually attempted it? Oh, yeah, I just said that. That was the first one. How many? Four of us, maybe? Yeah, five? All right, the mains and myself. I'm not planning on doing this, and you'll know why in a bit. I'm not going to orchestrate this, but I had a chance to go spelunking, and here's what spelunking is. It's a really cool way to say you're going to explore a cavern or a cave. So spelunking to me has all sorts of funny images in my mind of me falling, of me not getting lost, or me getting lost in a cave, but it actually is really fun. I was invited to go spelunking. And it was a good friend of mine who, they're youth pastors in Tucson, and there's a cave called Pepper Sauce Caverns. And it's something that is just known. Now, I grew up in Tucson, had never done that, and so I said, yeah, we're doing it. So I actually brought a crew of teens down to Tucson, and we're going to go spelunking. And then the other church met up with us, and they had a group of teens, and we went spelunking. So I had all these images in my mind about what that was going to look like. And I will say this, some of those images were correct and some of them were not. That as I got there and I got into the activity, it played out different than I thought and what I had expected. Now, here's the first difference. The first difference is, I don't know why, but in my mind, we all kind of parade through this wonderful opening that, you know, has a slight shadow, so you're losing a little bit of light, but you're excited about what's still in there. That we walk in with hard hats that have lights on the top. Don't laugh at me. That's exactly what I thought, because that seems reasonable. So one, I didn't bring hard hats with lights on the top, so that's not going to happen, but we brought flashlights. The other is that entranceway was about this big. I would never have known to crawl through that thing. So in fact, so much so, I didn't trust, this is the only time I didn't trust that youth pastor, and I was like, that's not the entrance. And I thought he was just trying to get me to like give it a shot, give it a go, and then laugh at me later when it just doesn't go anywhere. And then, so his crew started going through, and none of them came back out, and I was like, well, five of them aren't gonna fit if it doesn't go somewhere. But I was really surprised at how small and narrow the entrance was. And then I really was kind of in awe of how much it can open up once you get through the entrance. Now, I know I'm only 5'2", and everything seems big, but it just really felt big going through this small space and then having it just expand bigger than what I had thought. And that was just the start of it. The cavern's pretty... pretty long and big. It's also something I had never done before. So I want us to be thinking about that. I'm going to come back to that in a minute, but we are actually going to continue the I am statements, but we're going to stay in I am the bread of life. So I began last week with that I am the bread of life, but realized, you know, this passage is so big, I'm going to have to break it into two sections. So you're welcome. So we didn't stay until 1 p.m., but there's so much more in this. So we're going to go to John chapter 6. Margie, not only did I didn't put my glasses around my neck. All right, carry on to John chapter 6. And I'm going to give the recap. For those that weren't here, or just so we are remembering. And if this was a television show, right, they do the recaps, you can skip it. Nope, you can't. We're going to go through it. But I am going to do it as quickly as I can. If this were being played on television, you would have the crowds gathering, you would have disciples of Jesus kind of a little frantic, and then you would hear one of them say, "Where shall we buy bread for all these people to eat?" And then the camera would pan to 5,000 men plus ladies and children, and then you'd have a disciple kind of embarrassingly walk up to Jesus, and the clip would say, "Well, here's a boy with five small loaves and a couple fish." Oh, was that me? Whew. Again, I feel like we're, I'm gonna let Ruben do it. Do we need to pause that while we, okay, all right. Does anybody else get nervous when that stuff happens? My ears. All right, ready? One. Oh, yay, Ruben! Will that fix it? Maybe. Okay, we'll find out. Right, isn't it amazing when there's such a small little fix to something? Thank you, Ruben. You do not want me pulling things from up here because I would not know what to pull out. All right, so then the next thing that would happen is Jesus would calmly tell the disciples, have everybody sit down in groups. And then the camera would come up close and he would say, I've got this. Not really, but that's what I envision. Then the next scene, we would just see the crowd eating and Jesus continuing to multiply the bread and the fish. The next scene would be then all of those disciples, same disciples are in the boat, 12 of the disciples, not all that were trying to learn from Jesus, but those 12 in a boat. And the camera would be showing that it is starting to get pretty ugly and bad, that Jesus is not there. And then they would show Jesus off in the distance in the water. And Jesus would say, "Don't be afraid, it is I." And then they would welcome him into the boat and the waters would calm. So we're heading into John chapter 6, and it is just after both of these miracles that Jesus is going to give us an idea of who he is and what the kingdom looks like with an I am statement. So he is going to say, I am the bread of life. And we're going to pick up in a little bit more of what that interaction looked like between his statement and the crowd, between his statement and those 12 disciples that were close to him. If we start in verse 35, I think we can make our way through this. All right, verse 35, they're in this discussion. Jesus declares, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me and still do not believe. All those the Father gives will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all of those that he has given me, but raise them up on the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up in the last days. At this, the Jews there began to grumble about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, I came down from heaven? Reasonable that that question would be asked, because they did know his story. They knew his family's story. And for him to say, I came down from heaven, this is how much they were unsure of what heaven looks like. Is their eyes had told them, no, we know his start. We actually know his whole family. How can he say, I am the bread of heaven? So it's going to continue. They began grumbling, and this is how Jesus answered. He says, stop grumbling amongst yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me, draws them. And I will raise them up in the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he can see the Father. Now I'm going to pause right here. So my mistake this morning actually may not have been that bad. Because what we read from in the beginning of John is that in the beginning, Jesus was. That the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So we actually took part in proclaiming that this morning. What Jesus is trying to get those around him to understand. Now, this is really a difficult teaching. It's very hard to understand, and I believe in the moment, even more difficult to understand. But Jesus is giving us information about the kingdom, and here he's just got done saying, you need to trust the one who's come from God, because only I can give you the truest version of the kingdom of God. And then he says this in 48, I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, and yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that comes down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. Now, it's easier, I think, on this side of history to read that and understand what Jesus is saying. I think the questions that are being asked probably would have come from my mouth had I been in that context. To understand that somebody has come from heaven, the fullness of who Jesus is probably not something any of us can fully grasp. But Jesus is going to continue to teach, to open up this idea of, let me tell you about the kingdom of God. Now, he's going to continue, and what we'll see is in his descriptions of who he is, there are two revealing themes. And one is that the will of the Father will happen through the Son. There's this connection point of him and the Father. And then the second thing is the theme of redemption, the theme of salvation, the theme of reconciliation between a broken people and a holy God. And so he's going to continue to make those connections, and he's going to place himself in the middle. I had somebody tell me years ago, you know, it's hard to explain who Jesus is, and it's hard to understand God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, this Trinity. So we cling to these words, who Jesus is. We cling to what he says about himself because he's opening up pieces of heaven for us to look at. And we were talking about, this is clearer for us on this side of the resurrection. that we see Jesus's body was given, that he died for all sins. And so we can see that. And I remember Linda told me years ago in high school, she said, you know, it's kind of almost like a filter, which a holy God can see his people as holy through Jesus. Because if I were to stand before God without that filter, all of the things I am that are not holy would be made evident. And Jesus comes in between to say, let me show you the way. And because of his sacrifice, I somehow can become holy. That part I'm still figuring out. But it is in Scripture. It is something that we strive toward, not in perfection of all things, but just in the release of letting Jesus be all things. He can fill us. So this is going to be a tough teaching, but God is saying, through his Son, I have designed eternity for you. So follow after me. Jesus is going to say this over and over. Believe in me. This is the Father's will, that you believe in me. And if we believe in him, then when he tells us to head a direction, we should be good to do that. So here's what's going to happen. As he gives this incredible piece of all of eternity, and he says, trust me in this, the people are going to begin to argue and fuss with what they know, which is very limited. And I find it interesting that they're going to be very picky about when they accept something that is impossible, when they make a drawing line between, well, that's possible, but this, that's impossible. And so they're going to start talking about, this is ridiculous. Now, also remember, they heartily accepted the miracle of the feeding of 5,000. That is impossible. That should not have happened. 5 loaves, 2 fish, that's not a thing. And yet the people were like, this is great. And they took it in. That the disciples actually saw Jesus walking on water. That also is not a thing. There's the impossibility there that Jesus made possible. And the disciples, after a while, were in awe. Begin to understand he can do the impossible. But people are going to struggle. So we're going to read through, starting back in chapter 6, verse 52. So then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves. How can this man give us flesh to eat? And Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up in the last days. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. So he's drawing this connection between a holy God and us, and he's saying, I am going to provide what you need. And he says, this is the bread that comes down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. And he said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. So the disciples are with him, but there's a lot of questions this brings up. So it is a difficult teaching, even in prepping for it now, when we have a better understanding of it. This idea of when he says, eat my flesh, he says it 4 times. 4 times he's making it clear, this teaching. He says, and actually he throws in a bonus, and I'm the bread of heaven. So he mentions the bread being eaten 4 times. And then he also mentions the idea of drinking blood. And that, again, is difficult teaching. And he does that 4 times. So any repetition is worth looking at, but when it happens 4 times within the same short pericope, paragraph, we should probably look at it. Now, is that as gross as it sounds? No, and yes. It is pointing to his sacrifice, which was gruesome. I find it interesting how easily we can discard something that sounds difficult, or it really does sound gory, but we're happy to accept anything that sounds glorious. And so he's giving this hard teaching, and he even says, "For my flesh is real food." Well, that's disgusting. So we have to look at what is Jesus actually saying and doing. Because if anybody starts to eat another human, one, I think you're arrested. I'm pretty sure how that plays out. But also, there's only so much, and so, like, that's not even a possibility. Christ is actually referring to a couple things. So he is setting them up to understand when it happens, they're going to see his flesh torn, and they're going to see that his blood was spilled. He's actually asking, I want you to join in with me. And this is going to look a little different than you think. Over and over, Jesus is trying to prepare the disciples for, this is going to look a little different, but this is the will of my Father. Now, we also know that since God is good and all the time, that he has the right path. But just like me heading into that cave, that small entrance, I didn't see what's on the other side of it. I'm grateful that our guide did and knew what was on the other side. And so I followed him because he has been in Pepper Sauce Canyon before, or cave or cavern, whatever it's called. In fact, he's been there many times, and I know several friends who had gone and went exploring with him. I trusted Jeff because I didn't know what's on the other side. I would never have said, let's check this out, and gone in that way. So it's interesting because God is going to be giving us this message, and in this, the message is Christ will die for us. So this message of death, however, still has life within it, because over and over, he's associating that with life and life abundant. He's associating that with life and life eternal beyond this. So he says, the living Father, he's the one who sent me. And I live because of the living Father. And you too will live because of my sacrifice. Sin does this thing to separate us from God. But Christ makes it possible for us to live into, through his Spirit's guidance, not a cleansing, that's what we celebrate in baptism, but then to a different way of life. Jesus had come from before, he is now, and he always will be, because he holds eternity. Now, I will say this, if we were to look at, if you've never been to Pepper Sauce, as I got in, I was in awe of what it opened up for me. And I start thinking about, you know, Jesus is going to say, I'm the only way. And that may seem small and narrow, but he knows what's on the other side. And it's bigger than what we can imagine. Way bigger than Pepper Sauce, by the way. That's probably actually pretty small in comparison to other caverns. But when I went in and I realized, oh, this is really cool, I kind of stood up and it was very fun to just explore. And my guide helped me explore. A couple things I noted is there were passages in which he said, don't go that way, come this way. But it looks great. It looks like, but I want to explore that. That looks pretty fun. Those formations right there are really neat. And one of the times he had to stop and say, I mean, you can, but here's what's going to happen. You're going to get trapped to where you think you can kind of slide through, and it's going to be narrower and narrower. And then anybody else who comes alongside that also is also going to get jammed in there. And then you're going to panic, and you're all going to have a hard time getting back out because it actually leads nowhere. And I started thinking about how much does Scripture say you don't want to go that way, because that's not going to be beneficial. In fact, it leads to death. Thankfully, nobody died in the canyon, just to let you all know, we came out. So I listened to him, but then I went rogue. I said, okay, well, you know, so I won't get myself stuck there. And, I mean, this guy's, he's 6'5". He's a big guy. So if he can explore all these things, I'm pretty sure I can. And so everybody's kind of taking a little water break. And caves are interesting because, like, the way the walls come up and things are formed. There was, like, within my grasp an opening and then almost, like, little stair steps to it. So I didn't ask permission. I just thought, I'm going to explore this. I mean, what could happen, right? The last few times we went in somewhere small and we came out somewhere big. I'm pretty sure I will find the new part of pepper sauce that nobody did. And so you know what happened. I got in there and kind of crawled in there, and then I was like, oh, I'm about to belly crawl. It'll be worth it. And I'm belly crawling, and I got myself wiggled in somewhere that I realized I don't think it's going anywhere. My light is still showing just all brown. There's nothing else there. And then my mind did this. Are there snakes in caverns? And I realized, I don't really want to be here because I don't know where it goes. I don't know how this turns out. And I shimmied real, I mean, my heart was racing at that point once I had that image. I shimmied back out, to which our guide was like, what'd you do that for? Yeah, there's all sorts of spaces that lead to nowhere. And he basically, in a kind way, was saying, would you just listen to me and follow me? I know, I've been here. I know these things. So I will tell you about the bunny hole. I did that. I had that experience. I'm carrying with me that weight. I have one teen who is not really excited about heights or tight spaces, but bless her heart, she came with us. And she is a nervous laugher. And so poor Robin was giggling pretty much the whole way through. We had to go up. There's a ladder area. Oh, that poor girl. She just kept giggling and giggling. Our guide thought she was having a blast, but she was just terrified the whole time. So not only did we get her up and over this part, but then there's a part, and they call it the bunny hole, or I don't know. It's more like Rabbit's Revenge or something awful, because he disappeared. Now, he knows multiple ways of things, but he kind of disappeared, and then you just hear him yelling. One of his students was like, yeah, you have to go in this hole, and I'm like, but I could hear him on the other side. And so I really had to trust my guide that this is going to go somewhere, and all of us, both my group and your group, will have room on the other side of this. And it was such a weird, I think they called it the bunny hole, I don't know, but you had to kind of go in and then turn around, and it's just dark, and you don't see anything. As I'm in it, I realize how much I'm trusting my guide. Jesus is doing the same thing. Hey, it may not look the way you think it's going to look. And I will tell you, the entrance is only through me, because I have come from heaven. And so not only does he give us eternity, but he's going to continually say, I am the bread of life. And that's life now. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full, is what he says. So Jesus is begging us as we read this to understand him as the bread of life, the thing that sustains us. That he is the one who we need. And so he's going to continue on. And it's interesting, the responses that they have. But he's desperately trying to get them to understand something bigger than that moment, than that lunch time. They came back because they know he provided food. And he says, man, I can give you what you need to feast and to live in bigger ways than you can imagine. So we're going to pick up in 60. It says, on hearing it, many disciples said, this is a hard teaching, and who can accept it? Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of spirit and life. Yet some of you do not believe. For Jesus had known from the beginning which one of them did not believe and would betray him. And he went on to say, this is why I told you, no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them. From this time, many disciples turned back and no longer followed him. So he looks at his 12 and he says, do you want to leave too? Oh, you do not want to leave too, do you? Formed in the question. Jesus asks the 12, and so Simon Peter looked at him and answered, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. Peter has come alongside Jesus and has watched how Jesus interacts with people, has absorbed these miracles, and is affirming, I believe you have the words of life. There are a lot of people who could tell me how to live life, but I want to follow yours. And so he's left everything to come alongside of Jesus. But then Jesus replies and he calls out one of the disciples. He says, "Have I not chosen you, the 12? Yet one of you is the devil." And he meant Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, who, though one of the 12, was later to betray him. Now, it's interesting because he says it is God who has to draw you in. But he also gives us, and here's the will of my Father, that everyone who believes in his Son will have eternal life. And so we hold both of those intentions when he calls out Judas to know, he said, "Did I not call all 12 of you?" That Judas is given the chance to come and to believe, and yet Judas is going to choose another path. I'm actually really grateful I didn't choose another path, and I was regretting in the cave when I chose my own, because it did not turn out as well as when I listened to the one who knew the cavern. And so Jesus is telling you, I am letting you know, I know about the kingdom of God because I've come from it. That I am, and he grabs something from the miracle and pulls it out in a metaphorical way. I am the bread of life. You enjoyed the picnic, I get that. You saw that this should not have happened and you easily accepted it. I need you to believe in me and accept my teachings. And he says, I am the bread like you just ate. I am the bread of life. And so when we celebrate the sacrament of communion, we actually are partaking in that which the early church did do, that which he brought his disciples up to a room to take part in breaking of bread. Bread has significance all throughout Scripture. Jesus knows that not all are believing. He sees it. People hear hard things and they walk away, and it does not stop the truth being the truth. I want to read a passage, and then I have actually asked that communion be prepared. So I'm going to read a passage. We're in a minute. I'm going to instruct those giving communion where to go. But Jesus is in the communion elements that we take together. So again, symbolically for us, the bread is his body broken. And so as we partake in it, I will recite that part of Scripture. Now, I know we only get thin little crackers, but to break it is an appropriate response, to remind ourselves that he was broken on the cross for our sins. And then we'll take the cup, and we will again declare it was his blood that was spilled. And so we partake in that together. Now, those are symbols of what Jesus had done. But Jesus wasn't just talking about the Last Supper or how communion would build from the early church forward. He was saying, I want you to know there's a bigger picture here with my sacrifice. It's going to be tough teaching, but here's maybe a little more of what that looks like. So, you know, it's great, Pastor Krisi. We know this, we saw and have read through John, we get it. I'm going to read a little part in Colossians before I have the attendants come up. Colossians chapter 3, I believe the author is trying to repeat what Jesus is expressing, trying to teach and give verbiage to this. So in Colossians chapter 3, it says, "Since then you have been raised with Christ." So all those believing in Christ, asking for the forgiveness of sin, believing in who he is, and then going to Scripture to learn how to live life in the daily. It says, "Since then you've been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things." Do you hear that tension they had? They were in a place where Jesus was doing miracles and they were focused on something that was temporary, something that was eternal, and Jesus was trying to point them to something that is eternal. So here's how it plays out. It says, "For you died, for those of us that are following Christ, and For those that are not, this is the open invitation. And your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. And then it says this. So here's how it plays out. This is why it matters. When we commit to Christ, what we see in Scripture is there are several things that are, hey, don't go that way. It narrows down toward death. Don't go that way. It looks tempting, but there's stuff there you don't want to get involved in. That there is this sense that Scripture gives us not only, hey, God loves you, and so much so he sent his son so that we could all join in the eternal kingdom. But it said, he says this, since we know all this, verse 5, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these. You know, the first list may be easy or easier, but then here we have the things that pop up every day. Anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed. It's not a one-time deal. Jesus is here for us and new every morning, new glories, new mercies every morning. You put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge, the understanding of who Jesus is, in the image of its creator. And then he says this, here being the kingdom of God, there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. There's something about us understanding Jesus as the bread that actually puts us on a path where we do become dependent on him for life. That we do look to him and we follow his direction because he opens up the kingdom to us and there is more that we can understand and see and know with him. So today we are going to take communion and in this one, we're just going to be still before the Lord. So those that are serving, will you follow Emily to the back and go ahead and pick up your elements and come forward? When we take communion, we are doing this. We're remembering. Jesus says, whenever you do this, remember me. And so I'm going to ask that this morning, we actually, as we receive the elements, that we just kind of set aside any distractions. It may be you have to kind of close your eyes and bow your head. It may just be that you can sit before the Lord. And that we remember he's the bread of life. That this hard teaching actually leads to, you guys can come forward and we'll pray before we pass them out. That his sacrifice actually leads to greater things. It opens up the kingdom of heaven for all of us. And so this may be a time where you kind of sit before the Lord and just have a conversation. That the Lord meets with us corporately now, but also individually. So I'm going to pray for the elements, and then as you receive them, just hold them, and we will take them together. Will you join me in prayer? Jesus, Lord, we come before you, the one who is our salvation. And Lord, we do this in remembrance of you. Lord, we actually proclaim that you died for us. And then we also hold the hope that you are coming again and that we can be raised to eternal life. And so, Lord, we are so grateful that you are the bread of life. As we break bread, as we join together in this communion, may your presence just continue to be known, and may we be receptive to it. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. If there are any who need gluten-free, will you just kind of raise your hand? Emily has our gluten-free option. Thank you. Thank you. Did you get your ring? Okay, it's very important today. Thank you. Do you have yours? So as we're distributing the elements, I've shared multiple times that communion is just one of the special things we get to do together. It's part of who we are as community. We actually come to the table of the Lord. And there's so many times where as I just sit before the Lord, he expands my understanding. So much so, I'm not one to see images and dream dreams, but years ago, it was very clear. I just went to block out everything that might be a distraction. And as I heard the footsteps, there was just this holiness in the sound of people coming to the table. And I'll never forget that. It has changed me. And then this morning, as I sat and I listened to my own instruction, I started thinking about, I wonder what it is like. It is so difficult to take up our own lives. That when I was spelunking and I did my own thing, it sounds fun, but I had the most anxiety when I stopped listening to my guide. And then I'm wondering, you know, what it looks like to really stop wrestling and to just sit before Jesus and say, Jesus, will you guide me? To release our life to who he is, and that's some of what he can do for us. And if you don't know that, come find me after church, because I'll walk you through and tell you as much about my Jesus as I can. Because Jesus was clear when he said he wants everybody to believe in the Son and have eternal life. So on the night that Jesus was betrayed by Judas, he took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same manner, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for the sins of many. Do this in remembrance of me. I'm going to have the worship team join me on stage. We're going to close in a song, and the song only begins to touch on it. In fact, I think it's in the song that if we wrote everything about what Jesus has done, there's not enough ink or paper. And so we come before that God. And that's the God who does such tremendous things that he invites us to come to him. And so as we sing this, will you stand if you're able? But we're going to just open up the altars. If there's something you want to bring before the Lord, praise, petition, you're welcome to join us up front.
How great the pain of searing love.
sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my rent. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Pray with me. Jesus, Lord, you are gracious in your word. You are gracious with the presence of your spirit. And so we come before you, and Lord, we ask for more of you, to know you more, Lord, to hear your voice. And then, Lord, we want to follow. Lord, we want to not just believe, but actually surrender our lives to you. And so, Lord, is there more than one of us as we gather, and there are many in this room. Lord, we know that you care for and have a plan for us individually. So, Jesus, will you help us walk in that this week? Lord, as a community, we pray for those that are struggling. Lord, we pray that, Lord, they'll sense your presence, that this journey may not be all the things that we expect, but we can be assured that you will provide what we need in the midst of difficulties. And then, Lord, for those of us that might come and our hearts are full, may you get the glory for the things that are done. And then, Jesus, as we go out into this world, Lord, may we be your light. Will you fill us so much that what comes out is your light? And Lord, will you give us the words to speak, the eyes to see? And Lord, may we encounter a broken world with the compassion you have, and with the truth of your word. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. God is good, and all the time, and I am his witness. Amen. You're dismissed.